As some folks continue to filter in, good morning. Let me speak a little more directly. As you come in and begin worship, you're finding that David or Jeremy is here playing the piano. As you've already discerned, that's not for your entertainment. It's not request to him. It's preparation time. It's a time to allow the lyrics that go with many of these songs that are being played by both to prepare our hearts for worship. And that's what the call to worship is. It's a call to turn our hearts. God's called us together. And so now we come together and we place our focus on the Lord. What the Lord wants to do this morning, not only corporately, but personally. If you are here and you have a prayer request, we don't want you to leave without that prayer request being addressed. And so you can see me at any time. You can give me a copy of the prayer request or some cards that you can fill out and put it in the offering boxes in the back. Or you can give it to me after worship and we will pray for whatever that need is. If you have a continuing need, update that. And I would be grateful. At the end of our service, our worship, there's going to be two offering plates. And I'm going to, at the end of the worship, I'll put it up front. There's a need within our family. I'm going to go ahead and start it with $150 right there. So you don't think, okay, it's empty. That'll be in there when you come forward. And we may even carry it over next week. But there's a need within our family that... as a church body, it would be wise and it would be obedient to the scriptures to come alongside this family and help them. And so if you would pray about that even through this worship service and even for next week, at any time you could send it to the church. If you have any questions about that, you can see me. But thank you for your willingness to give even sacrificially to this family that finds himself in need. As we continue with our worship, Psalm 95 is going to be our call to worship as we focus on Him. The psalmist writes, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let's shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Amen. Praise be to God. Glory to God on high." That's the truth of God's word. Let us come before His presence with thanksgiving and let us shout joyfully to Him with praise. Why is that an odd thing in a collected assembly to shout out the goodness and the glories of God? For the Lord is, He's great. I watched TV last night. I won't tell you what I was watching, but there was a lot of shouting when greatness happened. You fill in the blanks. Nobody held out. They wanted to. May that be our heart's desire. To just as willingly proclaim the greatness of God. And as the great King above all gods. In His hand are the deep places of the earth. The heights of the hills are there also. The sea is His, for He made it, and His hands formed the dry land. Oh, come. Here's the call again. Oh, come. Do we have to be called? Do we have to be exhorted? Do we have to be encouraged? Oh, come, let us worship. And there it is. And bow down, prostrate ourselves, humble ourselves before Him. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God. And we're the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand today, if you hear His voice. Through the spoken word, through the sung word, through the prayers, our call to worship. Let's pray. Father, we have come together. You have called us out, and we are excited to worship. And it's not about all that we're going to do, but it's what You're going to do as we place ourselves before You. The God who controls all things in heaven and earth, the skies and the sea and the land, our hearts and our lives. Oh, God of glory, this morning, you have called us here with intention and purpose. And you know what you want to say to your people. So may we be receptive to hear through song, through your scriptures, and by way of truth that the Holy Spirit will lead us in as we worship you in spirit and in truth. And so, Lord, you know our hearts. You know our needs this morning. We open our hands. We unclench our fists. We fold our hands. We bow our knees and declare our dependence upon you, O God, for all the things that we need to live a life of wholeness and completeness and maturity and patience and endurance. Glorify yourself, we pray, as we worship you in spirit and truth. And all God's people said, amen. They're there.
As our children go to children's church this morning with Miss Carolyn, we're going to stand and worship. And I'm prepared for God to do something great this morning in our midst. He's something, we know what, has been trying to work against us. Cheryl and I both kind of had an incident this morning after we practiced and warmed up. So let's stand and worship God this morning and just give him your honor and your praise.
From the burden of sin, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the shine. Thy dross to consume, and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose,
I will be up here. Alice referred to the trials, the little tests that we had before worship. We had an issue of blood, and we accomplished it. You won't really have any notice if you look around, but it was quite substantial. And then someone took a little tumble shortly after that, and so we've had some testing of our faith as we've prepared for our worship. Last week, I closed out the message by challenging you and encouraging you. And I don't know how this happened. It never does, but it did this morning. It's off, but take that so I don't get distracted. Thank you. To rather than focus on your own needs as you're going through the trials, we tend to do that pretty nicely. Is I wonder if you found someone to come alongside of and walk through a trial or a burden or a hardship or a suffering or a difficulty with them. I'm not going to ask for any raising of hands, but I hope that that the Lord led you and used you to do that. There are plenty of opportunities just here within our body where our faith is being purified. If you have your Bibles, turn to James. We'll be in the first part of James again. We're not going to get away from the subject that we talked about last week because the Lord made it really clear there's some more things that we need to affirm, some things that we need to latch onto. Nobody likes to talk about trials and suffering and hardship and difficulty, but yet it comes to our life just about every single day. As we think about different types of trials that we can go through, I want to encourage you this morning to begin to look at your own life. You'll begin to naturally start to look at the lives of others around you. And so look and see where and what type of trials and testing and hardships and difficulty and sufferings that you're dealing with. Some we bring on ourselves because of what we reap and what we sow. It's for disobedience. It's for sinfulness. And then for other reasons, it's to purify and to refine our faith. So physical. I mean, there are many in our body and many that are in our community that are struggling with physical issues. Not just health issues, but constant continual pain. Some of you live with a handicap, and so you've learned how to live with that. Many of you have had surgery recently or even waiting to have surgery. If I say this following word, scan, if in the last 2 or 3 weeks you have dealt with somebody or you yourself have had to deal with somebody that's had a scan, just raise your hand. Yeah, scan? Really? Yeah. I mean, it's not a positive thing. I'm going to go have my scan. Pray. You know what that means. And so we think that may not be a painful thing, but it is a physical issue. There are financial ways that we are tested and tried, or we suffer and we go through difficulty. An emergency need can pop up. Suddenly you need something that's going to cost a lot of money. Maybe it's a car repair. Maybe you need a new roof and the roof's starting to leak and now it's going to cost even more money. Maybe an appliance just went out. And of course, the warranty ended when? Yesterday. That's exactly right. So then that adds to another stress or strain. The kids come home, they say, you know, I need new shoes, I need new, and so we have kids that can present financial needs, or even a medical expense. There's ethical things, ethical trials, and sometimes those kind of bury in us the deepest, because somebody's come to us and said, would you mind doing this? Yeah, but that's not ethical, that's not right. There's ethical things. Somebody may ask us to do something. Somebody may ask us to say something. Somebody might even ask us just to give the opinion that this is. And we think, but that's not true. One of the greatest crises I had in my 15-year business career, somebody gave me privileged information. And I could have acted on that to great gain, or I could have not. And so that's one of the greatest ethical dilemmas I've ever had, because nobody would have known except the person who told me. And so by the grace of Almighty God and the wisdom of Scriptures, but that's one of the greatest ethical concerns that I've ever had to deal with. It can be an emotional stress. See, we think, well, stress is, it's got to be physical, it's got to be painful, it's got to be something fleshly. No, it can be emotional. Life could right now just be breaking out a lot of little bitty fires, and so the emotional stress that you're under right now is just ratcheted through the roof. And every little thing just might set you off because of heavy, heavy stress. Maybe there's something in your life that you're fearful of happening, or you're even fearful of it not happening. Boy, if that doesn't happen, I don't know what I'm going to do. And so we can be fearful. Some people deal with the condition of being bipolar. And so there's those seasons that people who deal with bipolar are going through, or even OCD. And so it puts us in emotional circumstances. There's relational. Right? I'm not just belaboring this. We're going through this because we're all going through this, and it'll make us empathetic more than sympathetic and reactional to the needs of people. So relationally, maybe there's somebody at work that just, they know how to push your buttons. They just know how to push every one of your buttons. So it may be somebody at work, maybe somebody in the house that's dealing with some issues that you're having to deal with and to work through. It could be a neighbor. It could be a neighbor who's doing something you like, or he's not doing something you would like. There it comes again. Here's one. Relationally, there could be somebody in your life, let's do it that way, that's provoking you, poking you with that stick. And every time something happens, every text, every email, they're just poking you with that stick. And so there's this provocation, and so it's a trial and a test how to respond. Maybe you're having trouble with kids or grandkids. I think I'm the only one here with perfect grandkids, so I don't have that problem. I can help you with yours. But maybe your kids or grandkids are going through some things or experiencing some things that are bringing about conflict. And you know, we haven't even got to the spiritual side yet. The trying and the testing and the pressure and the heat that comes from conviction of sin by the Holy Spirit. Maybe there's a willful sin that we're just not willing to give up. We're not wanting to give up yet. We don't feel it's our turn. We talk about spiritual sin and conviction, lust of the flesh, 1 John, lust of the eyes and pride of life. That's where they all come back to. Now this list could go on and on and on, right? And so here's the thing, we are all facing various trials. That's the beauty and the practicality of James. James chapter 1, I'll read 2 through 4. My brethren, believers, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, multicolored, variegated is that word, trials. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect or complete, mature, and lacking nothing. When we fall into various trials, the scriptures are clear. They're not calling us to grin and bear it. Just grin and bear it. Just do the best you can. The scriptures don't tell us look for ways to avoid it. And it certainly doesn't say that we are just ignore it and it'll go away. As born-again believers, as disciples of Christ, and that's those of us who are intentionally spending time with Jesus. Not just for what we can get, but for what we can give Him. But we intentionally spend time with Him. And we learn how to be like Him. And we learn how to live our life as He would live our life if He were us. And so how would He handle these stresses? How would He handle these problems? How would He... Well, we'd look at the Scriptures and see. I mean, there were days that He spent morning to night ministering to the needs of those who were suffering and had trials and hardships, difficulties. And we see how He dealt with that. And so these words that we seldom want to hear and we seldom say to ourselves when we go through patience, endurance, wholeness, completeness, those are things that really describe our life when we're going through it. I'm going through a trial. It's hard. It hurts. I don't like it. I'm alone. It's only 5 short chapters. So practical. But they're going to teach us how to cultivate. There's the proper word. What things do you cultivate? Things that have, you cultivate a garden. You cultivate your health. You can cultivate something that you may be writing or working on. It's going to teach us how to cultivate a healthy spiritual life and walk. Amidst our trials that we're going to face. Now here's, before we go any farther, let me encourage you, and you just go ahead and say, do you believe that's possible? Do you believe it's possible to have a healthy, mature, good spiritual life and walk in light of what you're going through? And so the answer is, well, I guess if I believe in Jesus, yeah, I'm supposed to say yes. It's not what you're supposed to say. Where does faith take you? Job 5:7. Man is born to trouble. What? As surely as sparks fly upward. It's an absolute, it's no way to say, you know what? There is trouble in my life. Heartache and pain and loss and suffering, those are absolute guarantees in your life. And what have we reminded ourselves of many, many, many times? When someone says they're not under the hand of God, when somebody says that they don't feel the pressure of the Spirit convicting them in their life, what do we say about people who are just as happy as they can be walking through? They're not God's child. You're just not God's child. Well, how can you say that? Because all God's children are getting it. All God's children are getting it. Not vindictively, but for our benefit and for our good. Man's born to trouble, and it's not trouble that's brought on to us. And so through these trials and these hardships, God teaches us to endure by relying on Him and relying on His provision. And so we must not fear God's allowed test. We shouldn't fear and flee from that. Because as Adrian Rogers says, God doesn't allow tests or trials in our life to cause us to stumble. He allows them to show us how to stand. Right? That's Ephesians 6. Go to Ephesians 6 if you want to see that. So He's going to show us, here's what, I want to teach you how to stand during these times. I'm not going to try to trip you up. God in His goodness wants to give His children true riches. And He wants us to know that life's greatest gifts come from Him. Now, I don't want to hear an amen or a testimony. But there's many in this room who found this. One of God's greatest gifts is patience and endurance. Because you learn some things patiently enduring that you wouldn't have learned any way else, and you know that now. And if I hadn't have gone through that, if it hadn't have gone God's way, if I'd gotten out from under that, if I'd found a shortcut, if I'd done something else, then I wouldn't have learned that lesson, and I'd still be wandering like the children of Israel around the proverbial desert. So this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to look at some benefits from trials and suffering. I would hope that already there's three or four things that you could just pin down if I gave you a minute to say, well, see, that when I suffer and I go through trials and hardships, here's some things, not just that you've learned, but benefits that come from it, because God has woven those in, and we see it right here in our text. We want patience, but we don't want to really have it develop God's way. We want endurance, but not God's way. We want maturity, but not through that channel. We want it to be kind of like our TV. We want to pick our channel and pick our genre and pick our time. And then when we can't see it, we'll save it to the TiVo and we'll watch it later when it's convenient. So what are some of the good? What are some of the benefits? Benefits, things that add to that God provides. All right, so first is this. I'll look at five this morning if we have some time. Trials and testing and hardships help us to see clearly what's important. What's important? It's kind of like just a puff of wind that gets all the smoke out of the kitchen. Now you can see how much fire, how much damage the fire caused. It tells us what's really important. Let me say that another way. When trials, suffering, and hardships come, it gives us a new perspective. A new perspective. It doesn't so much change the one that we have, but it gives us a new perspective. Suddenly we're seeing something and recognizing something that we didn't do it before. Testing will do this. It will help us see God for who He is. And testing will help us see ourselves for who we are. But let me say that in a more definitive way. It will help us see God for who He is, because God's God and nothing less. Nothing less. And He'll help us see ourselves, and man is man and nothing more. So we see that perspective. We see the greatness of God. We see the glory of God. We see the dominion of God. We see the immutability, how God is not, he's changeless. We begin to get this fresh new perspective. And then we begin to understand and we proclaim, God is in control. God is in control. When you really get off base, when you really start to tumble, did the person that fell over here hit the ground? No, they didn't end up hitting the ground, right? Even when things happened this morning, God is in control, not because of the building that we're in. And I think it's Charles Swindoll that says this: anything under God's control can never be out of control. Anything under God's control can never be out of control. Though we may perceive that and have that perception, we come back to get this new perspective and we see what's really important, and that's this: God's got it. That didn't mean your pain's going to ease up any. But we get this new perspective. We discern Him correcting. And we see God correcting because He's letting us know that you're off the path. That's going to harm you and hurt you. That's not walking in accord with the spirits of the truth. That's working against the graces of God. I want to work into your life. I want to bring you back in. All right? And I don't know how many times that my dad would, you better straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and fly right. I knew exactly what that meant. I meant somewhere at the end of that flight was a razor strap, right? And I didn't want to go there, but straighten up and God, He wants to bring us back on the path. They want to correct us. God does. And then we discern His perfecting. That's the two kind of trials. One that'll correct error, sin, wrong, selfishness, worldliness, all that. And then the other that's perfecting, where God says, no, you're on the right track. Don't give up. Endure. Come on, press on. Come with me. Remember? Discipleship, spending time with him, learning to be like him. And so we're following him. Paul says, you follow me as I follow who? Silas? No, Christ. That's exactly right. And so we fix our eyes on Jesus. Hebrews 12:2. Do we have that? Looking to Jesus. Not to save and rescue the author and finisher. And there's the word again, faith. Who for the joy that was set before him, he endured what? He endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand in the throne of God. Now there's a perspective. There's what's important. We see truth about our relationship and our dependence upon God. That's what we really get perspective of. And we find out this, I'm trying to do it all myself. And he's saying, child, trust me. It's just like a small child in the family that's trying to do something they could never, ever do until finally you go over and you say, not let me do that. That's condescending to the child. Let me help you. Let me help you. So enduring child's will give us a new perspective. Here's one I struggle with. I wanted to take it out because some of you might as well. I didn't struggle with it because of its truth. I struggle with it because just of the application of it, and that's this. One of the benefits is enjoyment. Is enjoyment that comes out of a testing or a trial. Let me say this. I've been through too many trials that I can look back and say I found joy and enjoyment in it because I recognize this. It wasn't near as bad as it could have been. And it wasn't near as bad as it could have been, not because of God's vindictiveness or anything else, but because of my stupidity. I didn't give it up. I kept on thinking, oh, that's okay. I just whistled through it. So we rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say what? Rejoice. When? Always. So there is a rejoicing that takes place. And it says, consider it all joy when you walk through various trials. Consider, measure, weigh, count, intentionality. Look at the lives of the saints of God. And we'll look at that towards the end of the message. And we think we see the life of David, Moses, and others who boasted not in themselves. John 17:16. They're not of this world, just as I am not of this world. What does that mean? It means this. We're just passing through. Right? These, you know, and it came to pass. So our true spiritual reward awaits us. And so we can find joy and enjoyment in the fact that with the right perspective, we know that this is all just temporary. It will come to pass. Hebrews 11:25. Choosing rather to suffer what? Who chooses to suffer affliction? Those who understand the nature and the character of Christ. Suffer affliction with the people of God, then enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, especially when we're reaping what we're sowing. Moses, he chose to suffer affliction with his own people rather than what? Rather than be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose that. That path. So through trials and hardships, God teaches us enjoyment. Some of the greatest things that's happened in my life did not come through ease. It didn't come through comfort. It didn't come through a great personal pleasure. But it came through difficulty. It came through pressure and fire. 2 Corinthians 7:4. Great is my boldness of speech towards you. Great is my boasting on your behalf, for I am filled with comfort. I am exceedingly joyful in what? In all our tribulation. No, these are sick people. These are people that don't understand. They don't get it. No, they're people who understand the character and the nature and the truth of God and His Word. So this may be, I guess that's part of the reason I struggle to include that. That may be the hardest one, is to find enjoyment, to find joy. And so how do you get joy? It's a fruit of the Spirit. Don't reject it. Don't reject it. Allow Him to deliver that to you, and then receive that grace gift from God, and watch how He uses that in and through your life. Third benefit that comes. Trials, hardship, suffering, pain, all of that, it humbles us. It humbles us. It makes us lay prostrate before God. Now, we will lay out, any of you with back trouble, any of you with any kind of physical issue where you've just got to kind of lay out and just get still and hope it stops hurting or it goes away. We've all been prostrate. The issue is, do we call out on God when we get that way? And it's not just a physical condition. It can be a spiritual and a moral condition where we're just on our face. But do we cry out to God? But when we humble ourselves, it'll make us more teachable, not about life, but about the ways of God. Look, we know how life works. We've got Google. We know how everything works, whether it's true or not. But do we know how God works? Do we know God's ways? And so we've all found that trials and failures, they humble us. We find out that we're a man and nothing more. And we see what our limitations are. We see things that we need to correct in, or that needs correction in our life, things that we need to learn. I don't know that much. Let me tell you, some of you here could just stand up and say, yeah, that's the truth, maybe not in a positive way. How many times I've come to you and I said, I don't know how to do this. I need help with this. Will you help me? And not just because I'm your pastor, but because I confess my need. I humble myself and say, if you don't help me, I'm not going to really get this done. It happened this week 2 or 3 times. And one person, and they're here right now, I went and I said, certainly he's going to help me. I got this problem. I explained the problem. I even took pictures of it and showed it to him. And so I couldn't wait to get rid of this problem, because this problem is, it's like your problem, David. It's a serious problem, and it's been long and protracted. And so that person told me what I should do and what I ought to do, and sent me on my way. Some help that was. He didn't fix it. He didn't do what I asked him to do. He didn't make what I wanted him to make. And he could have easily, but he didn't. And it, in a very positive way, it humbled me and it taught me. Everybody, even if I ask nicely as a pastor, not everybody's going to do what I want them to do, the way I want them to do it. And so it's going to send me back to either myself, this kingdom of Bill over here, send me back to myself, or it's going to send me back and say, okay, let's see, now let's see who you turn to. You're going to go to God with this? You're going to learn through this? You're going to be humble and teachable through this? Humble and teachable. When people learn to play the piano, they learn with chopsticks. And so there's a coach or a teacher, and they sit there and they teach them how to play the piano. And they may teach you how to play the guitar. And it looks so easy when the teacher does it, and it's so hard when the student does it. You may be learning some kind of craft or some kind of hobby, and there's somebody that's come alongside you that's helping you do that. But here's what happens. If anybody's going to be teachable, if anybody's going to be humble, if anybody's going to learn how to do something, even if it's a sharp skill, it's going to take some help. So whatever it is. See, when I played ball, here's what was easy. Before practice really started, we would get out there and play, and we had a lot of fun. It was fun. We did what we wanted to the way we did it. But then something happened that just tore everything up. The coaches showed up. And it's no more of these shenanigans. And it's no more one-hand catches. And it's no more hot dogs. And it's no more practicing a victory dance. No, here's what it is. Get in line. Let's get to work. And here's what they show you. They show you where you're not teachable. They show you They show you what you're not doing correctly. So the last thing we want is the coach coming along saying, you don't reach that fret like that. No, you'll never. But it won't work. It's not going to happen. You can't play that way. You can't do that. And so the coach comes along and just absolutely just sucks all the joy out. Because they want our harm? No. Because they help us see ourselves objectively. How many times have you, well, that's what I did. That's what I said. It's a great commercial, the Progressive, where suddenly they have these people that have a conflict, and then one of them throws the flag. Have you seen it? And then they go get the video and say, well, let's play this thing back. And then the truth comes right out. That's what a coach does, what a mentor does, what the Holy Spirit does. He helps us see ourselves objectively. Shows us where we err and where we need. That's why they film every single practice, everything they go, you see that? That's wrong. See that? That's wrong. God, I couldn't see it myself. But see, may the tension in the room ease a little bit. We're not looking for perfection. This completeness is not perfection. We're looking for Christ-likeness. Christ-likeness. And that's a lifelong journey for us. So if we're humble and we're teachable, then we'll be constantly in that, spending time with Jesus, learning how to be like Him. And so it's about Christ's likeness. But here's what's going to happen too, a little caveat on the end. When we're humble and teachable, and God reveals it to us, we're not going to know that, right? Seldom do we know that we're really becoming humble, but others do. And so it's going to inspire and encourage others to want that humble, teachable spirit. So that comes through trial, and it can come really no other way. Another benefit and blessing that comes out of our trials is it develops our moral character. Okay, yes, it is patience, yes, endurance. We looked at that last week, but it develops moral character. I wrote this before the game last night, but in my notes it says that Tennessee has a big game, the biggest game, against Georgia coming up in a week. Wouldn't have been that big if things hadn't gone last night. To prepare and get ready, they're not just going to have one practice this week. Says we're going to do it one day this week so nobody gets hurt. We're going to hit it really hard, and we're going to be ready. It's going to be 24 hours a day. Not only is the preparation going to be 24 hours a day, it's been season long. We've played lesser and lesser and lesser opponents. There's been trial after trial after trial after trial, test after test after test. And see, these lesser trials is what's starting to work to produce the character that we might see, at least in a team. What I'm trying to say is this: moral character doesn't come with one huge event and one solitary victory. It just doesn't. But it comes through many daily tests and hundreds of monthly tests. Two here, three there, one there, three here, two there. They just continually come. So this continual parade of testing and trial is going to establish in us moral character. Romans 5, 1 through 5. Having been justified, made right with Christ by faith, not our works, not self-righteousness, right? Understand that. We have peace with God through Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into the grace in which we stand. Grace is the goodness of God, that which we don't deserve. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. We're going to read through verse 5. And not only that, but we also, we glory in tribulations. We glory in trials and hardships, knowing that tribulation will produce perseverance. And that perseverance will produce character, even moral character. And this character is going to give us hope. Verse 5. Now, hope does not disappoint us. This is the word of the Lord. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. God makes provision. He didn't just call us to his task without equipping us. But it's not self-righteousness and it's not our moral character that justifies us. It's faith in Christ alone. So is your moral character in process? Is it being refined? Are these characteristics a part of the life that somebody would claim that you demonstrate when you go through hardships, trials, difficulties, even suffering? You know, when David stood before Goliath, did he say, you know, I've never killed anything before, but maybe this will be a good time to learn? David learned long before that. He learned when he was just a shepherd boy out with a sling, when he would kill smaller animals, and then maybe he, but we learn, we develop this moral character over time and over the testing of our faith. Well, last trial for this morning, the last benefit or blessing that comes from trials, and I hope many of you are making a list and saying, oh, I'm going to go back and watch the video. It makes us fully dependent upon God. Trials will make us fully dependent upon Him as we learn more and more about His character and His nature in the person of Christ. We learn that He already knows the truth. I can tell Him the truth. He already knows everything about me. There's nothing to hide. I can humble myself before Him. But here's the key, and here's what the Scripture says. It says in verse 4, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect, complete, mature, lacking nothing. Dependent on God, lacking nothing. Oh, wait, this is kind of one of those like Greek things, right? The Greek means this and that means that. And that doesn't really mean is it really that clear? Yeah, it really is. Dependent upon God, wanting nothing. I didn't say needing, but I said wanting nothing. If our life did not have trials, if our life did not have hardships, if there was not suffering, we wouldn't need patience and endurance. See, people here with kids and grandkids have a patience and endurance that people who don't have kids and don't have grandkids don't have, because that's the only way you get it. Some of that, right? At least in that particular bent. Let patience have its perfect work, wanting nothing. Second Corinthians 6:10. As sorrowful, Paul writes, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. I don't want to rush through that. There's a proof text for everything we've been talking about. Sorrowful, but yet always rejoicing. Poor, yet making many rich. And then here it is, as having nothing and possessing all things. Does that get close to your camp? Here's what I've got written next to that in my Bible. I don't know how long ago I heard it, Pastor. Penniless. Penniless, I own the world. Penniless, I own the world. Trials and testing and hardship, it enriches us. It enriches us, not financially, but by making us patient and mature and complete. And when we get to that point, we don't really want anything, because we've got all we need in Christ. Older saints that you may know, it's rare to find it in someone young, but older saints, when you really get to know them, here's what they're doing. They're lightening their load because they know they're just passing through and they're waiting for glory. And so penniless, they own the world. Give it away, you can have it. Want that? You can have it. Take it. I don't need it. I don't need it. I don't need it. James 1:4 assures us that we can come to that place. Do you believe it? Do you believe it's possible somehow to have a relationship with Christ that's so intimate, at least in some ways, let's don't say every way, but at least in some ways to say, you know what, I don't want anything. I've got enough in Christ. Well, that's foolish. Eat, drink, and be merry. That's foolish. Wanting nothing. Do we even want it? Whether it's possible enough. If you knew right now and the Spirit said, that's possible for you to want nothing, would we want that? Maybe I'd miss out on something. Yeah, and you'd avoid a lot of things too. Adrian Rogers says that if you want to know how rich you are and how much you've got to really give, figure up this. What money can't buy and death can't take, there's your wealth. Now how rich are you? What do you have in your life that money can't buy and death can't take away? There's where your riches are. There's where you're enriched. Let me say it this way. There's where you lack nothing. Because penniless you own the world and you've already got it all. Fully dependent upon God. And he can bring us to the place where we need nothing. Really. He can bring you to the place where you need absolutely nothing. When we made the decision to leave the business world after 15 years and go into seminary and to missions, it was a continual process of God just taking things away that we didn't need. Taking things away. And it was amazing. It was amazing what God showed us about ourselves and himself and how much stuff came in the way, got in between us and him, even desiring to serve him full time in the pastorate and then on the mission field. We got to a point where we had no necessity. They were all taken care of. Well, let's try to land this thing. Hardships, trials, and difficulties, they don't come from a harsh God. All right, they don't come from a punitive God, but from a Father who's concerned for our welfare and a God who weaves into our life benefit and blessing amidst the trials. Isn't that glorious? There's a time just for a hearty amen, hallelujah, praise God. That when he does so, there's blessing, even if we don't see it, there's blessing and benefit in our trials. And so our challenge is this, is to run to God, not from God. It's to humble ourselves before him in prayer and declare our you know, prayerlessness is a declaration of independence. I don't need you. I won't talk with you. We won't discuss this, God. And so we run to him. And we resist the urge and we tell him what he already knows. I want to run. I want to run far away. I want to flee. I want to get out from under this. I want to do whatever I got to do to make this go away. I want it to stop. Or we wallow in our pity. Woe is me. Do you see me suffering over here? Are you going to do something to come fix this? Pity and wallow. First Peter 1:6 and 7, do we have that? In this you rejoice now for a little while. If necessary, you've been grieved by various trials. Grieved by trials. All right, that's the truth of it. So that the testing of your genuineness of your faith, is it real or not? Is it in God or yourself? Is it self-righteousness or is it the grace and mercies of God? More precious than gold that perishes, though it's tested, it's refined, may be found to result in the praise and the glory and honor at the revelation of Christ. We don't invite grieving and trials and testing and suffering. We don't say, bring it on. But we have to deal with it every single day. So may the Word of God, not this mess, but the Word of God bring us comfort to know that patience and endurance and maturing faith can come. David Tripp, and he's got a devotional, New Morning Mercies, he says this, times of difficulty are never objects in the way of God's plan. Don't see them that way. See them as opportunities for blessing and for benefit. They're a part of His plan. And here's it. As Tripp does, it's part of His redemptive plan for us. It's one thing to say it's His plan, but it's another thing, it's part of His redemptive plan. What does He redeem us from? How do His graces arrive to us when that happens? In grace, He leads us where we didn't plan to go in order of producing us what we could not achieve on our own. There's some things we have to go through, because that's the way we learn, and that's what we'll learn. So we could take a moment. We're going to close with Acts 16. But we could look at Abraham and Isaac, or Jacob and Moses and Daniel and the children in the fire. We could look at a lot of biblical characters, and we could glean many of these benefits and these truths that we've looked at this morning. But I want to close with Acts 16, verses 22 through 34. Talking about the blessings and the benefits of trials. The multitude rose up against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates, they tore off their clothes. They're pretty ticked. All right, they're ticked and commanded them to be beaten with rods. Think that's going to hurt? When they laid many stripes on them, they threw them into the... They didn't let them go. They threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them secure. The only way he can keep them secure is throw them inside the prison. So when they laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them secure. Do you have an extra? Well, let me go back to... Bear with me or turn to Acts 16. Then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. There it is. Having received such a charge, he put them in the inner prison. Not the outer. He put them in the inner prison, and he fastened their feet in stocks. Do we get the picture of what's going on? This is damp. This is rat infested. We can't imagine what this is like. There's no way. But at midnight, something happened. Paul and Silas, they were praying, declaring dependence upon God, not their independence. And they're what? They're singing hymns to God. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. And to God. And the prisoners were listening to them. The prisoners were being comforting by their rejoicing and by their joy, because that's the Spirit of God at work. And suddenly there was a great earthquake. Did they ask for it? No. What happened? God sent it. God provided, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, not just some. And everyone's chains were loose. Not all, everyone's. And the keeper of the prison, waking from his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposed that the prisoners had fled, he drew himself his sword, and he's going to kill himself. This is serious business. And Paul called out with a loud voice, saying, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light, and he ran in, and he fell down trembling before Paul Silas. This man's humble, and he's suddenly teachable, because he's bowing at the feet of these prisoners. And he brought them out and he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved? What do I do to enjoy this redeeming grace of God? I'm not worried about what the authorities are going to do to me. I want to know the authority. Here's my real need. Here's my real need. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved, you're in your household." And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all who were in his house. They took him the same hour of the night, and he washed their stripes, and immediately he and his family were baptized. There's how you respond to a trial. There's the graces and the mercies of God. See, we'll leave it at here. we'll pick it up with, you know, the scripture says that we're to know and we're to ask God for wisdom and pray. So we're going to look at that verse 8 as we continue. But see, we have this capacity that we think we're not getting any of the grace of God if we're having to suffer. Right? If God's grace was really upon me, I wouldn't be suffering. But here's the thing. God knows that that's the kind of grace that we need. It's grace amidst suffering. And if we'll open ourselves up to that truth and recognize that's a channel through which God can do, it'll be amazed at what God will do with your faith, right? Your faith as it's active in His person, His character, His power, His ways. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You for your word. We thank You that you are teaching us through Your word by way of Your Holy Spirit, and we're beginning to understand. Are we obeying? Only You know that. But Lord, we thank You how we're beginning to understand how and why we're going through trials and suffering and testing and difficulty, and that we're not alone, and that our glorious Savior can relate and identify with everyone. And so we thank You that You have made provision to not only see us through the fiery trials that we face, O God, but to do so joyfully, to do so patiently, to do so wisely, causing the world to look at us and say, like the jailer, what must I do to not live like You, but to have that kind of hope and peace? Because my problems are killing me. My struggles are killing me. My pain is immeasurable. And I just want to end it. I don't want to learn anything through it. Oh God. As You continue to mature us, and as our faith continues to grow and develop, we ask that it would bring You alone glory and honor, none to ourselves, and that through even our trials we might see the kingdom of God grow as You allow us to touch others' lives and be channels of Your truth and Your grace and Your mercy, Your love, Your compassion, and Your forgiveness. Boils down to faith alone and Christ alone. And if we possess that, penniless, we own the world. Receive our praise, O God. May Your Spirit continue to teach us as we continue our worship. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with us as we continue our worship in song this morning.
It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your praise again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. I scarce can take in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and
as Bill was saying, and I think that the scripture is very clear about, and experience will tell you it's true, life is full of difficulty and hardship. Wednesday night, we had a student. She had inhaled some chemicals during chemistry class earlier that day and had burnt her lungs a little bit, and so it hurt her more and hurt her more and hurt her more, and she didn't know anything about it, and she has bad anxiety, and she started having a panic attack. So I go to take her home early, And I get pulled over because one of my headlights is out. So she's having a panic attack while we're being pulled over. She can't look at the lights. So she's having a conniption in the passenger side seat with the other kids in the back. And then the officer comes up and he's like, "Your registration has been out for a year." So now I'm stressed and she's certainly stressed because she's picking up on like, oh, this is not good. But the humorous side, I get her home and her driveway is full of cars. And she walked in on the whole family together because her grandmother had passed while she was a youth. So it was just one thing after another, after another, after another. And life is like that. Like Bill was saying, it's either a big fire or a series of small ones. And the end result's the same. And that's just the desperation, the frustration, the anger, and sometimes the bitterness that comes from it. And all the scripture that Bill shared today can be summed up in this way. If we look at Romans 8:28, and Paul says, "And we know that God causes all things, whether a broken leg or a kidney transplant or a bad spill on a bicycle and nerve damage and a thousand things besides, panic attacks. God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose." And this represents a greater truth in Christ, that God is so radically for us and loves us so much that He'll even use the consequences of our sin to bring about the greatest good for us and in us. And so we are not left to walk this earth where we just like trip and fall over and over and over again, believing that God is a cosmic sadist or that somehow we deserve this because of our sin, which we certainly do. But God is for us because of the work of Christ. And let's go to Him this morning and thank Him for that. Father God, we recognize this morning that the only thing that we deserve from You is Your wrath, that all of Your grace and all of Your love, that Your comforting hand should not be extended towards us, but taken away. And Lord, because of the work of Jesus Christ on His cross and in His life, Lord, and His resurrection, we come this morning with all of our pains and all of our hang-ups and all of our difficulties and all of our struggles over sin and the thousand regrets that we have, and we lay them out knowing that You are for us and that we have received forgiveness and grace and mercy that is new every single day. Lord God, Your love for us is just untold. We cannot see the end of it. We cannot count its riches. We cannot find its depths. We cannot know its height or its width or its breadth. Father God, thank You for Your love for us. And thank You for the work of Your Son, which is more than sufficient to draw all of us to overcome our sin and our failures and to bring us into Your household so that You might call us sons, and that we might run to You when we fail rather than run away from You. Lord God, thank You for this grace that we do not deserve this morning. Lord God, please fill us with the knowledge of Your grace and mercy that we might be able to show it to others, that we might be able to endure under hardship, that others may look at the way that we endure and glorify You in heaven, and they would be drawn to faith in Christ because it would be clear in our lives that He is our greatest treasure and the one that undergirds us. We ask for these graces in Christ's name for our good, for the good of those that we will suffer with and who will see us suffering, and that You might be glorified in all things, even in our difficulties. And amen.